So, hello friends. So this time I will be discussing friction and a very important aspect in tribology. So let's start with this lecture. So talking of a friction, a very conventional definition which we all know very well. That is, it is a force that opposes the relative motion between the two bodies. Or between two objects, or rather between two contact surfaces. That's the best way to express. Because when we talk about friction, we shall focus on the contact surface rather than the body. Then yes, it generates heat and thus results in wastage of energy. No doubt, in some of the application, friction is inevitable. We want friction to be there. And yes, it results in wastage of energy. But in other applications, we can minimize friction. Where the friction requirement is not there, we should minimize friction as far as it is possible. So many researchers have worked upon this concept of friction and given various laws. And whatever we do, whatever components we design with reference to friction, we are making use of those laws. So I will just discuss in brief some of the laws, just for the sake of information. We should know about those laws. As Leonardo da Vinci in 1493, so he did some experiments, and what he concluded, so I will just present the conclusions. He said that the force of friction is directly proportional to the normal load rather the applied load, and also he said that the friction force is independent of the contact area. Now this was the observation given by Leonardo da Vinci. Now, it has been observed during the past century that many researchers have countered the work given by the previous researchers, and some of them extended the previous work also. So that is how the research goes on. Then Coulomb's law, a well-known name, in say around 1785, I have just shared one of his important observations. He said the force of friction is independent of sliding velocity. Now this was the observation given by Coulomb. Let's see some more researches. Now Strybeck in 1902 and Rabinowicz in 1951. Now again they did some experiment on some grounds. So what they said the friction does depend upon contact velocity, but there is a non-linear relationship between the friction and contact velocity. Now you can see the Coulomb in 1785, he said there is no relation, it is independent, friction force is independent of the sliding velocity. But these gentlemen, Strybeck and Rabinowicz, they proved based on the experiment that there is a relation between friction and contact velocity. Now likewise, many people have come up with their research outcomes. So as an example, some of the name I will quote here, you can see, as Tustin in 1947. So, as per Tustin, the relationship between the friction force and the velocity was there, but it was exponential. Now you can see, he said exponential. Then Bow and Pavelisu in 1982. So, what they said the relation is somewhat generalized. They also agreed there is a relation between friction and the velocity, but the relation is generalized. And Hess and Soom in 1990, they said the relation is Lorentzian. This is Lorentzian type of relation between your friction and contact velocity. Then Armstrong in 1991, he said there is a Gaussian relationship. Now you can see how the things have moved from the past to the present. So people have been working on this concept of friction, because friction may depend on many variables which we are not aware of. So these are the outcome given by various researchers which help us in applying the concept of friction practically. So let's move ahead. Now friction, yes, it influences the performance and life of materials. There is no doubt about it. So that way we can relate friction with sustainability, or we can say green tribology, a well-known name these days. Everybody is running after this green tribology, sustainability, because it also adds to the safety of the people and also add to the economy of a nation. So green tribology or sustainability and friction, they have a strong relationship. Now let's see How? So sustainability means energy preservation, and we know that friction, it consumes a lot of energy, or we can say friction rather reduces the mechanical energy of the system, because we have to spend some force, or say spend lot of energy to overcome friction. So that way, lot of energy is being wasted. So if we can reduce the friction, we can save the energy, we can preserve the energy. So that way, it has a strong relationship between with the sustainability of green travel. There is no doubt about it, because we have certain applications. For example, your brakes, clutches, where we need to have high friction. But in that way, we can decide the contact materials which are safe for the humans. Because when friction will take place, some heat will be also emanated from there. So if the materials are friendly for the humans, so that won't make much difference. So let's see the other factor, environmental protection. As I was telling you, there is a heat wastage of when friction takes place. So heat is emanated to the environment, because we have a lot of industries, or almost every industry is having moving parts. Industrial sector like automobile transportation, lot of mills are there. So thousands of moving parts are there. So heat is generated, and it goes into the environment. So we have to protect it. So that way we can decide the contact materials which are safe for the mankind. So yes, that way also friction relates to the sustainability on green tribology. Then comes quality of life, no doubt about it. Right from your walking, your sleepers, your shoes, to big vehicles, you drive vehicles, and the industries, wherever you go, it touches your life. So by reducing friction, we can improve the quality of life also. Because when you talk about friction, we should never forget friction means energy, the loss of energy. And energy affects everyone in this whole universe. It affects everyone. So that way, the quality of life can be improved if we reduce friction. So one relation, very common relation, which normally we use, as we know, the force of friction is proportional to your applied load, or the normal reaction. So as given by the Leonardo da Vinci. So we are using this law, and we have been using this in number of machines. We have our friction testing machines, so we are using this law, and we are getting good results. See, that is how we implement the research. The research done by the scientist, the outcome, based on outcome, we can devise some testing equipments, and if we get the safe results, the same thing is used in industry. So let's move ahead. So now we will see various causes of friction. Now we can classify the causes as surface interactions. The interaction of the surface is one of the causes of the friction. And in this category, we have molecular adhesion. We are just classifying the surface interactions. Then we have surface roughness. And then we have surface deformation. So these three come under the surface interaction. Same way, we can say energy loss is also a cause of a friction, because friction leads to energy loss, or if we say that there is some energy loss taking place at the contact surface, so friction is there. So we can relate them. So that we can say energy losses, we can categorize energy losses to be a cause of the friction force. So energy loss during elastic deformation, plastic deformation, and asperity fracture. So that is how we classify the causes of friction forces, or the causes of friction taking place between two contact surfaces. Now let's try to study this. We'll start with molecular adhesion. Now, as the name itself clarifies, what does it mean? The adhesion at the molecular level. Now, let's see what it is. The two materials at their contact surface start interacting at atomic and molecular levels. It means when two materials, let's say this is one material, when it is brought in a close proximity to the other material, so the interaction of these at the atomic level, it results in the development of electromagnetic forces. So yes, that you can see here, the electromagnetic forces. At this point, the electromagnetic forces, these are not the asperities, these are the asperities. Just when these two materials are brought in close proximity, the electromagnetic forces will develop and there will be adhesion because of these electromagnetic forces. That has been shown here, you can see. Now, due to this, adhesive bonding will develop. Now, when sliding will take place, certainly some force will be applied. Some force will be applied on the member. Let's say this force is applied on the member. So what will happen? These adhesive bond will break and there will be a resistance. And this, when you break the bond, there will be a resistance and thus there is a friction. So that is due to molecular adhesion. So a note is there at the bottom of the slide. See, initially the scientists or the researchers were of the opinion that friction was only due to the mechanical part, that the surface roughness. But after doing a number of experiments, they realized that these adhesive forces also add to the friction. As I was telling you, many causes are there. So people have been exploring all those causes. So let's move. Now surface roughness, yes, so very very common term we know. So as we know, none of the surface is frictionless. There is roughness in the form of peaks or valleys on the surface. You can see here, so you can see these peaks and valleys, these peaks and valleys here. The interaction of these peaks and valleys creates interlocking at the contact surface. Suppose there is one more surface with its asperities. Now when they both come in contact, so what will happen? You can see here, the interlocking develops. So we have thousands of asperities in a contact. So when a force is applied for the sliding to take place, so what will happen? Let's see, a force is applied, this is action. So you can see numerous reaction will take place at this contacts. We have thousand of contacts, and if we take all the reactions collectively at all the asperities, so that becomes a resistance and that is a friction force, which is due to surface roughness. A very simple mechanism, a very basic mechanism, which was explored at the earlier stage, and then the other factors of the other causes of the friction were explored by the researchers, and still that research is on. As an example, you know what is a sandpaper. So if you rub a sandpaper against some material, it clearly gives you an idea of surface roughness, and it removes the material also. Now basically, the asperities of a harder surface will remove the material from the asperities of the lower surface. So that leads to wear. We are talking about friction. So let's suppose this black surface asperities are more harder than this asperities of this blue surface. So what will happen? Initially, when interlocking is there, I am talking about friction. I am talking about that static friction. So when the contact takes place, the moment you apply force, at that very moment, all these asperities will react, and that is friction force. And after that, the material will be removed, and that gives you now that depends upon the hardness of the material. So let's move ahead and see what is next. Now comes surface deformation. Now yes, we know what is deformation. That deformation can be classified in several ways. First, let's see. Deformation takes place when asperities penetrates into the material. As I was telling you, if one material is more harder than the other material, the asperities of the harder material will penetrate into the surface of the material which is relatively soft, and then these asperities sinks in the surface, resulting in large deformation. Let's try to understand this here. Let's say the red one here, this is a, let it be a steel. For example, let's say this is a steel body or steel asperity. Now, and this we can take to be a rubber, just for the better understanding. Let's say this is a rubber like material, a rubber or rubber like material. So what will happen here? Steel is hard, certainly it will penetrate into this rubber, and these are the deformations you can see in the material. This is the deformation. Now what will happen? Now the moment you apply this force, the deformation will resist this, the motion of this body. When you say this deformed surface will resist the motion, it means we are saying that friction has taken place. The resistance is friction. So here the resistance takes place because of the large deformation taking place because of its softness or because of its less hardness as compared to the other body. Now finally, what will happen? If this body is hard, the steel body has to plow through the surface for the motion. And remember, we are discussing at the asperity level, and we have thousands of asperities, infinite number of asperities. We are trying to understand the mechanism at that very point. So that is what has been said here. Because of surface deformation, you will get a resistance. That is sort of a mechanical resistance. And to move this body, we have to plow through the surface for sliding to happen. So these were the causes. As a note, as an example, the flattening of vehicle tires on the road, this we have observed number of times, a very common practice. When you drive a vehicle on the road, the material of the vehicle is soft as compared to that of the road. Now the asperities of the road will penetrate into the material of the material of your tire. So it means there the friction has taken place because of the surface deformation. So again, these are some of the examples what they have given, some of the classifications. We have a huge list of classifications. These are some of the conventional classification which we must know. So these were the surface interaction which were the main causes generally being discussed. And apart from that, we take energy losses to be a cause of the friction, as I gave the justification, because friction means energy loss, or the vice versa. If energy loss is there, that means friction is there. That's why some of the researchers, some of the authors have quoted energy losses to be a cause of the friction force. Let's see. The plastic deformation of the asperities at the contact surface. Because if you remember, when we classified the energy losses, so there I said plastic deformation, elastic deformation, and asperity fracture. These three things, when the plastic deformation takes place, energy loss is there. Okay, I will just read it out. The plastic deformation of the asperities at the contact surface, it consumes energy which cannot be retrieved, which cannot be recovered. So it means energy loss is there. Similarly, when elastic deformation is there, so no doubt elastic deformation means the material will try to regain back its initial position. But in doing so, energy loss is there. So which is generally termed as hysteresis losses. So these losses have not been observed in all the material, except for some more elastic material, just like rubber like material, which are more elastic. So these hysteresis losses have been observed there. So that means due to elastic deformation also we get energy losses. And when there is a fracture taking place at the asperity level, so energy loss is there, because the energy required to cause that fracture, so that is loss, that is energy loss. So, but these energy losses pertaining to the fracture at the asperities, they are negligible if compared with that to the plastic deformation cases. But still, here we are discussing the possibilities of energy losses. So, we have to consider the energy losses, whether it is plastic deformation, elastic deformation, or your asperity fracture. As an example, okay, let me take a hysteresis losses with an example. Say when an elastic material, again we'll take a rubber, and when it is in lubricated condition, When the sliding takes place of a lubricated rubberized material on a hard surface, for example, your tire of a vehicle on a wet road, so the energy losses takes place. How they will take place? As I was telling you just in the previous slide, that due to the deformation caused in the tire because of the asperities of the road, so that will be your elastic deformation, and that deformation is recovered. It can be retrieved. But those losses will take place, energy is consumed, so which is known as hysteresis losses. So that is why we take energy loss to be a cause of a friction. So we should remember friction force and energy losses, they are inevitable. Friction force will result in energy losses, or if you can locate some energy loss, you can say some energy loss at the contact surface, you can say friction is there. So this was about the friction, the basic introduction, some laws and the causes of friction. Now I would like to discuss rolling friction. Now when I say rolling friction, so it means one is sliding friction. So generally it has been classified, the friction we say sliding friction and rolling friction. Now what is a sliding friction? It takes place when one surface rubs against the other surface. We say sliding friction has taken place. Or there is a mechanical deformation, as we were discussing, whatever we had discussed, surface roughness and all the surface interaction, more or less they just relate to that sliding friction. So when we talk about rolling friction, let me quote an example. We have seen the package bags, heavy bags. Now, if you want to carry a heavy bag, if you go to the airport or stations, you'll find people just very, very easily they transport their heavy bags. Now, how? Because of the roller fixed at the bottom. Now, let's imagine if there is no roller, what will happen? The sliding will take place. So, a lot of energy will consume, a lot of surface interactions, and wear and tear will take place. So, no doubt rolling friction is very less as compared to sliding friction. But when we say rolling, or rather when we say friction, let me put it again in this way, when we say friction, it means some resistance is there. So that is final. So the term rolling friction. So ideally speaking, there shall be no resistance to the motion during rolling. If it is a rolling, so there has to be no friction, because rolling means just a point contact. So there is no resistance. But practically, energy dissipation is there. Now the cause of the energy dissipation may be different. So that was what was worked out by researchers. They found that there is a resistance, some sort of resistance happening in rolling also. So yes, the friction is less as compared to sliding friction. There's no doubt about it. Now the interesting part is, practically energy dissipation has been observed in rolling due to the following facts: micro slips at the contact, inelastic properties, and roughness. These were some of the causes found out by researchers. As I was telling you that if a resistance is there, there has to be some cause. So that is to be located. What is that cause? So moving ahead, I will just continue. I said researchers have given some of their outcomes. As per Renault, he said that rolling resistance is due to sliding of one contact surface along the other surface. Now Renault said sliding is taking place in rolling also. As we were discussing, sliding friction is different, rolling is different, but Renault said sliding is there in rolling also. And then irreversibility in recovering of the deformation. They said deformation is taking place in rolling, and if deformation is there, it cannot be recovered back, meaning energy loss is there. Again, friction is there. Then stretching of the rubber like material. That's very, very best example. If you have a rubber let's imagine steel on steel, and then you imagine steel on rubber. So what will happen? The rubber will extend. It will, when the steel asperity is on the rubber, it will extend, and if it extends, the slipping will take place. There you won't get pure rolling there, because the material has yielded. So that is one of the reasons. These reasons were given by Reynolds. Next, ideally, if the hard asperity, say if it is a circular asperity or a cylindrical asperity on the contact surface, on the other surface, ideally it should be on a single plane. There shall be no deformation. It means if this is your one asperity, sphere or a cylinder, this is the other. So this is a single plane. This is a plane. No, but on actual grounds, what happened? What happens? There is a deformation. The plane changes. It extends. So I will discuss it again. Let's move further. Now Heathcote, as per Heathcote, he says he's analyzed friction between rubber and between sphere and a rubber like flat surface. And what he found? He found that after one revolution of that sphere or cylindrical asperity, the advancement of the sphere or cylinder was less than the circumference of the sphere. Because if there is a rolling taking place, though after the one revolution, the distance moved shall be equal to circumference of that circle, circumference of the cylinder. But from their experiments, they observed that the distance moved is less than 2 pi r, less than the circumference. So let me repeat it again. As with their experiments, they said we have a roller. It is a roller. And if rolling has taken place, after one revolution, it should have moved a distance of 2 pi r. That is the circumference. But what they observed, the distance moved was less than this 2 pi r. It means, clearly it indicates some slip has taken place. If there is no slip, then it should have moved 2 pi r. So since it is the distance obtained and moved is less than 2 pi r, so it indicates the slip has taken place. Now then they try to locate the cause of that slip. So that was done by Heathcote. So I will try to explain that. So let's say this is a cylinder or a sphere. This is the center of rotation. Now you can think of it. Let's say this is rolling on a hard surface. This black one is a hard surface. So, and this is center of rotation. Suddenly when body rotates, it rotates about a center of rotation. So if it is a hard surface, ideally it will rotate. But as quoted by Heathcote, the distance moved after one revolution was less than 2 pi r. So what had happened? Again, we will take this cylinder. He said because of the deformation caused, because of the conformability of this cylinder or a sphere with the other material, as I have shown here, the deformation, this center of rotation has shifted downwards. So this is the center of rotation now, just above the bottom contact, just above the contact. Now you can imagine it, and how the radius of curvature has changed. So based on the experiments, they concluded that above this line there will be a forward slip, and below this green line there will be a backward slip. So that is how they concluded that slip is taking place. Now this was proposed by, say, the research in the past, which was not supported by many experiments. So still people are working on it, and they have found that the rolling friction is almost equal to the dry rolling friction. The lubricated rolling friction is almost equal to dry lubricated friction. So again, that research is on. So what we were discussing here was the word rolling friction. And as I said, if there is pure rolling, there will be no friction, as there will be no resistance, no energy loss. But when you say rolling friction, it means there is some resistance, there is some energy loss, henceforth friction is there. So that has been explained by the researchers. So one example I have tried to give you here, that because of the conformability of these two contact surfaces, the center of rotation shifts. Because of it shifting, the slip has been observed. It may be a micro slip, but it is there, and that has led to this friction force. So similarly, many more researches are there. So here I cannot discuss all the researches because there are mathematical expressions also devised by them. So it's very interesting. One who finds it interesting, they can go in depth and devise their own theory also. So this was all about from my side regarding this lecture. So hope to see you soon in the next lecture. Some of the coefficients I have quoted here, just as an example, just to show you the static friction, the kinetic friction, and the rolling friction. Static, we know, static means at the static condition, it's the impending case when the body just begins to move, when the asperities are in contact and the sliding has just started taking place. So the point at which the motion will impend, the motion will start, at that point frictional force is maximum, that's point 8. And after that, it decreases, the motion begins, the asperities break, the friction decreases. So that's called kinetic coefficient of friction. And rolling, as I told you, rolling friction is very less as comparable to your starting and kinetic friction. Now it depends on the application. We cannot have rollers in on all the application. So that is to be decided by the designers. We have rolling bears, rolling bearings, one of the best examples. We have many such examples. So this is all about the friction. Hope you had a certain some idea about friction, and I will meet you. Thank you very much for listening.